I'm Rob McCoy. I'm the pastor of Godspeed Calvary Chapel here in Thousand Oaks, California. And our church has been wide open, no masks, no social distancing since May 31st. Our local government has fined us, and we're in contempt of their restraining order. It doesn't matter. They have no authority to do what they're doing, and we're still wide open. And just to let Governor Newsom know, he doesn't have authority over the church, and he has no ability to declare the church non-essential. So, sorry, Governor Newsolini, doesn't work that way. This is a church, and we're going to enjoy services.
Pastor Rob McCoy, thank you for joining me today.
Thanks,
Jorge. We have an exciting conversation. Yeah, as soon as I got here, to California, I've been interviewing the restaurant business owners of what they're going through the lockdowns, and now I've been interviewing pastors who have been, you know, defying the orders and continuing to have service. So now that I'm here with you, I'm excited to get this conversation going. So we're here now in Thousand Oaks, California. But Rob, can you just tell me your reasoning for continuing to define orders, and how long have you been having the indoor services?
Well, I prefer to think that I am being obedient, not defiant. I'm obedient to God. I'm obedient to the founders. I'm defiant towards tyranny. And we've been wide open since May 31st. When we didn't know the severity of the virus and everyone was concerned about it, we abided by the CDC standards. But when our Holy Week came along in April, April 4th was Palm Sunday, and the governor declared that abortion clinics were essential, cannabis distributors were essential, liquor stores were essential, but the church wasn't essential. Look, I'm not going to argue over cannabis distributors and liquor stores being essential. I will argue over abortion clinics being essential. The decimation of children in the womb is unconscionable. But let's, for the sake of argument, cannabis and liquor stores essential. The one thing about those two is they're not covered by the First Amendment. The church is. And as you see this, and the governor comes out and says, no, you can't even do communion even if you follow the CDC standards. It's unacceptable. Well, we went ahead on April 4th, Palm Sunday, our Holy Week, with our sacrament, and our sanctuary holds 400 seats. We put 10 chairs in a sanctuary that holds 400 people. We had them distanced. We had each of the sacramental elements individually wrapped. Everyone wore masks. Every time someone got off the seat, we disinfected the seat. The press came out thinking we were killing everybody. And by their own admission, they realized we were cleaner than any quote-unquote essential business in Ventura County. It took us 3.5 hours to do communion on our Holy Week, Palm Sunday. I was sitting city councilman prior to that, but that Saturday, April 3rd, when I realized it got out on the news and that my colleagues on the council would have to censure me as I'd be violating this tyrannical order by the governor, I resigned my seat because I swore when I took that oath of office to defend the Constitution against all enemies, foreign and domestic. And I take that oath seriously. That Constitution, Jorge, it doesn't give us any rights. It constrains elected officials who are to govern by our consent from infringing on our inalienable rights. And when that governor violated his oath of office, I stood in opposition to it. And when the council was going to censure me in relation to it or considered censuring me, I resigned. And the onus is on the governor. The onus is on the elected officials who do not stand in defense of the Constitution they swore to defend. So we did communion. And then when the governor, and we still were very mindful of the virus, and then we started to see the data. And then when the governor embraced the BLM Inc., I refuse to call it Black Lives Matter because BLM Inc. is a Marxist organization. Black Lives Matter. That's not a question to anyone in our fellowship. That's critical to us. We all agree that. But BLM Inc., no interest in them. They are a Marxist organization. And when they started the riots in downtown LA and 75% of the businesses that were Jewish owned and operated that were burned and looted, and the governor is praising them and embracing them and blessing them, we were done. And on May 31st, we opened our doors wide. No masks, no social distancing. And we remained wide open. And then mid-August, three of our five supervisors decided to make an issue of it. We just wanted to be left alone, but they wanted to make an issue of it. They, they want the world to know they're in power. And so they enforced their authority. They found the ability between three of them to raise funds to get an attorney. And they found a political and predictive judge to place on us a temporary emergency restraining order. And of course, we violated that. And we've been fined ever since. And
what's the total, if I can't write? What's the total of
well, they were seeking $1,000 per violation. We have three services. That would be $3,000 mm-hmm. a Sunday. We papered that original judge, got a secondary judge. That judge reduced the fine from $1,000 per incident to $500 per incident. So every Sunday, $1,500. And if we have any other group meeting here, it's $500. Anytime we're not social distancing, anytime we're not using masks, $500. And that's been going on since August. And quite honestly, they're never going to see a dime of that. I'll see the inside of a prison before this county is going to see a dime of that money that infringes on our First Amendment rights. It's just not going to happen.
And Pastor Rob McCoy, right now, you know, here in California, we're you know, we've always heard that, you know, politics and the church should be separated.
Who said that?
but that's a saying that I've always heard.
Yeah, you have. Your generation has.
Yeah, but being here so far, you know, talking to other pastors, it seems like they all kind of had enough is enough, and they've been, you know, they're standing up. We're kind of seeing like a rebellion in a way. Not even just the pastors, you know, we're seeing with the restaurant owners.
Yeah, I'd say it's an awakening, not a rebellion.
Do you think that we're at a moment here in history where these two just can't be separated? They kind of, you know, we're just, you know, politics and the church are just kind of in a way intertwined with what's going on with the governor, how he, some pastors feel like he, you know, specifically targeted the churches in the beginning. Can you maybe just elaborate more on that?
Yeah, the idea of a separation of church and state, they call it the Establishment Clause. And they basically redefined the First Amendment. Congress shall make no law. And what they did in the ruling in 1947, I think it was they took 200 years of precedent and they reversed it to say that, you know, that there's a separation of church and state. Well, prior to that, it was keep the state out of the church, not the church out of the state. And then in 1947, they said keep the church out of the state. And that was based on this idea of a separation of church and state. What they quoted was a letter written by Thomas Jefferson to the Danbury Baptist Convention saying an invisible wall of separation. But in context, the letter itself was stating that the government's not going to infringe. We're going to stay out of your business. Now, for someone to say that I have to, you know, put my faith on a shelf if I'm going to step into the public square, what kind of insanity is that? And they say, well, you can't legislate morality, which is a moronic statement. Every law is based on someone's morality. You can't separate the two. Laws are based on morality. Aristotle said politics is the highest form of community. It combines morality with sociability. That's politics. And so we have to figure out how to live together. And somebody's values are going to operate in the public square. And I'll add this, as a minister, the church itself in the last 50 years has abdicated its responsibility in the public square. And by the way, you go ahead and do your homework on this one. I'll just give you the answer in advance. The very first Speaker of the House, ordained minister, take a look at it. They never intended to keep clergy out of politics. They never intended to keep the church out of politics. The point is this, Jesus said in Matthew 16, up at Caesarea Philippi, when he was talking to his disciples, and he says, who do men say that I am? And they go, well, some say you're John the Baptist, others say you're Jeremiah. He says, yeah, but who do you say that I am? And Peter says, well, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. And this is the kicker. Jesus turns to Peter and he says, Peter, he goes, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And then he says, upon this rock, I will build my, and everyone says, church. And then it goes on to say, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Jesus didn't use the word church. That word didn't appear until 400 years later. Jesus used a secular term. He co-opted a secular term that had been used in the Greek culture for hundreds of years. He didn't say synagogue for synagogue. He didn't say temple. He said ekklesia. Upon this rock, I will build my ekklesia. An ekklesia in Greek culture is real simple. It's called the public square. It's where the citizens would gather to figure out the laws for their community. And when the ekklesia would gather, there would be two words above the door of every ekklesia: isonomia and eleutheria, liberty and equality. That's the purpose of the body of Christ, is to contend in the public square for those things that would help the society. Galatians 3 says that the law is a school teacher and a guardian to protect us and point us to Christ until faith comes. And our founder said a different way. They said the laws of nature and nature's God. This constitutional republic realizes that our rights don't come from man, they come from God. 6,000 years of recorded history. 6,000 years of recorded history, every government's an oligarchy. And then for 244 years, we have a bottom-up constitutional republic that defines the sovereign as we the people. The first three words of the preamble, we the people. So we're accountable to God and we're accountable to each other. And as John Adams said, only a moral people can govern a republic. The clergy is critical. That's why they gave the First Amendment. The press is critical. That's why the founders gave the First Amendment. The press reports the truth. The pulpits proclaim the truth. The people live by the truth. And the truth causes a government, or I should say, excuse me, the truth causes a nation to flourish. But if you suppress the truth with a lie, it's no longer about truth. It's about power. And it's about indoctrination, not education. And so it's critical that the churches are open, the press is honest, and we serve the people. I don't know if that's an answer to your question, but that's what I got for you.
No, that actually did. Well, I wanted to ask you this, Pastor. What is the message, pastors like yourself and the other pastors here in the state who are continuing to have indoor service? What's the overall message you guys are maybe trying to send to the state and maybe the rest of the country?
Yeah, there was a Scottish clergyman by the name of Samuel Rutherford who wrote a book called Lex Rex. And King James said that he was the head of the church. And Samuel Rutherford and Lex Rex said, no, you're just a member of the church. Christ is the head of the church. The governor doesn't have authority over the church. He never did and he never will. It's that simple. I don't care how powerful he thinks he is. Even if he takes on El Dulce and he becomes Governor Mussolini, he doesn't have authority over the church and he never has. We'll willingly submit to an extent for the sake of our community, but we're not going to be forced to do it. And when we didn't know the severity of the virus, we willingly submitted. But when we started seeing the data and we started to realize that this is a gimmick, now granted, it's a contagious virus, but we now know who's affected, comorbidities, we see the data. I know the data up and down and back and forth and sideways. I know all the data in our county. We've been tracking it for over 230 episodes on our live stream. The governor cannot use this to infringe upon our First Amendment rights and to declare the church non-essential. He can't call the church non-essential. He's done. He doesn't have that authority. He doesn't have that authority in a constitutional republic. He never has and he never will. And then here is the part that's interesting. Good luck finding data on suicides in California. They're not dealing with the psychological, emotional ramifications of their draconian and tyrannical measures. They're destroying our businesses. 65% of our restaurants in our county will never reopen. Our children have been traumatized. You saw that 11-year-old boy committed suicide on a Zoom call with his classmates. What the heck do they think they're doing? This is insane. And what they're doing to families and the unemployment rate. And then he goes out to the French Laundry to have a meal with 22 of his cronies. Health officials, they all gather, shoulder to shoulder, no masks. Lobbyists. Their bar bill was $15,000. And an appetizer there is about $300-$400 a piece. That's the average of a welfare check for one of the citizens of California that has been devastated and lost everything they have. And he lies to us. And then he's laughing at us. And now he's giving us a 3-week lockdown and he wants to take away our Holy Week. He wants to take away Thanksgiving. And now he's going to push for Christmas. No. Liberty is not man's idea. It's God's idea. And he can take my church. He can take whatever he wants. He can put me in jail. But he's not taking my liberty. I will fight for my children and my grandchildren. I will contend with that tyranny. This is so critical. I'll leave you with this last thought, Jorge. 3 to 5 million Jews were enslaved in Egypt. 3 to 5 million Jews enslaved in Egypt, book of Exodus. They cry out to God to be delivered. God sends a deliverer by Moses is his name. And he contends with Pharaoh, Newsom, and he says, let my people go. He says, who is God that I should obey him? And so what he does is he doubles the brick output of the slaves and he reduces the materials. The slaves begin to complain. They complain to Moses. People want liberty. People want freedom. They just don't want to have to pay for it. And they don't want to have to suffer. They would rather have someone take care of them. And that's where we are today. People are willing to give up their liberty for the sake of security, and they're going to get neither. But in the church, I can't live with that. Liberty is critical. And so the Apostle Paul said, stand fast therefore in the liberty for which Christ has set you free. He wrote that in prison. Liberty's doing what's right. Freedom is having choices. And when you exercise liberty, you get freedom. And I'll leave you with this. These 3 to 5 million Jews, God sends the 10 plagues, 3 of which the Jews had to go through. Pharaoh relents and releases them, realizes he's losing his slave economy. So he sends his army after them. God drowns them in the Red Sea, delivers these 3 to 5 million people in the desert. There's no food, there's no water. Miraculously, God provides manna every morning. He provides water for 3 to 5 million people. He blows quail off course because they wanted meat. And their clothes don't wear out, their shoes don't wear out. It's all filled with miracles. But here's the greatest miracle that churches don't understand today. Moses goes up on Mount Sinai and he gets a downloaded moral app, the Ten Commandments, the Decalogue. When he comes down, the first 5 commandments is our relationship and our accountability to God. Second 5 commandments, our relationship with each other. Who are we accountable to and how do we get along? You don't steal, you don't lie, you don't covet, right? And you honor God, you're accountable to him, don't screw this up. When he comes down the mountain, Israel is in debauchery. They've got a golden calf. They've got a big rave party going on. I added that. And he instructs the children as God commanded on this moral law. And then he places it in the center of the community. And here's the greatest miracle. 3 to 5 million people lived together for 40 years without a police force or a standing army because they had moral knowledge. We don't have absolutes in our culture anymore. We want to dismiss the church. We don't see the need for the church. The church doesn't even think itself essential because they won't even open for a virus that has a 0.05 IFR fatality rate, or even some say a 0.02 fatality rate. In our county, it's 1/100th of 1%. And they won't open. Our continental forces were contending with Great Britain, the British Empire. They had already been immune to smallpox. For our continental forces who were dying of it, they had to inoculate themselves, and they expected a 5% death rate. And Washington said, we got to do it. And it meant their families would have a 5% death rate. And the families agreed to do it. They inoculated themselves. Thank God the death rate wasn't that high, but they were willing to face a 5% death rate, not to defend liberty, but only for the ability to fight to obtain it. We possess it, and we've had it for 244 years, and we are surrendering it for a virus that has a 0.05 fatality rate. We can't put up with this. He'll take everything we're willing to give him. And he doesn't get the church. It's not his. So.